and advise members of their ongoing obligation to declare interests. Remind members that the meeting will be recorded. All mobile phones should be switched off, not just on silent or airplane mode, that they interfere with the recording. And tablet devices can be put on mute by pressing the FM key followed by the F8 key. So, moving on to apologies, we have apologies from Anna Lowe, Sandra Overend and Barry McElduff. Any further apologies? I know some members are going to be late. Okay. Moving on to the Chair's business. Just want to remind you that next week's meeting will be taking place at the NILGA conference in Le Mans Hotel's Riverview Suite, and that five members of the committee, one from each party, have agreed to participate in question time panel discussion as part of the NILGA conference following the meeting at approximately 11:50 a.m. During next week's meeting, the committee will receive two briefings. The department will be briefing on the guidance on community planning and Windwatch NI on its assessment of the department's response to the committee's recommendations into its inquiry into wind energy. So what we did want to check with members was the start time of the meeting, because the panel will have to meet at a certain time. We're suggesting possibly a 9:30 start. Just want to throw that out and see what members think. If you think it's going to be too, you're not going to be able to make it to a 9:30 start, we'll have to be very tight on the times for the briefings and questions in order to finish in time for the panel. So what do members think?
I'll check that. Yeah, Murray's going to just...
9:30 or 10?
I'll have the flight times in.
Murray's going
to... just need to check the flight times in, Chair, to make sure we get in on time, you know. 9:30, way up the north. Yeah.
Murray, the Kerry warplane gets in at 9:30.
Yeah, the Kerry one. I know the Armagh one doesn't get in so early. So I know, well, Barry McAduff's attending on behalf.
For the panel, yes, he is, yeah.
So about 7 in the morning would be.
So any consensus? 9:30, 10 o'clock?
Chair, if it suits the participant from each party.
9:30.
It suits them, 9:30, whoever's representing the various parties.
The panel itself is at around 11:50, although it might start a bit sooner depending on how the progress of the conference goes, but we have agreed to meet anyway, hold our meeting in another room in Le Mans. So it's whether we start our committee meeting at 9:30 or 10 o'clock, but if we meet at 10, we'll have to start at 10 promptly to make sure that we're finished in sufficient time for the panel.
9:45.
Compromise, 9:45?
Okay, we'll go with that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so we'll move on to the minutes. You've been provided with the draft minutes for the meetings for the 2nd of June 2015 and the 4th of June 2015 at page 6 and 8. Are members content to agree the minutes? Thank you. Moving on to matters arising. Item 4.1 on page 15 is a couple of Kells Vocal's letter to the department providing its assessment of the department's response to concerns raised by the group. Kells Vocal has raised concerns regarding the possible use of PPS 18 in considering an application for a large-scale solar energy development in Northern Ireland in absence of the publication of the final strategic planning policy statement. Members, are you content to write to the department seeking some information? And that would be how the final strategic planning policy statement provides an appropriate level of strategic direction in relation to solar energy developments, the department's assessment on the appropriate strategic framework upon which the application referred to in Kells Vocal's correspondence will be considered, and the rationale for this, the timeline for publication of the final SPPS, the implications for the delay in publishing the final SPPS, what policy guidance is being provided to councils in relation to applications of solar energy, and a copy of the department's response to Kells Vocal. Members content that we ask this information off the department.
Content.
Great, yeah, great.
Okay. Members, there is a response from the department about the pollution on the 6 Mile water at page 3 of your table papers. The department states that while the period from 2010 to 2014 shows an increase in water pollution incidents, longer term statistics show an overall downward trend over the past two decades, particularly with regard to more serious incidents. The department also outlined action taken to prevent pollution, sanctions against polluters, and its discussion with NI Water, that is, isn't it? Yeah. So, members, are you content to note the response and to keep a watching brief on this matter?
Yes, Chair. I do think we need to keep a watching brief on this. This is, a serious enough situation. And one, I'm not absolutely convinced that the department's correct in its assessment. I think we should revisit it from time to time, just keep an eye on it.
Yeah, I think that would be appropriate. I mean, I certainly it affects me and my constituency very much so, and I would be in agreement with that, that we keep a close eye on what's happening.
Chair, I don't know that, again, I'm not sure that the response gives us any of the answers that we were looking for. I find it hard to credit. I have little knowledge of the 6 mile water, but I do know this, that it's frequently in the news for the wrong reason.
Mm-hmm.
It would be interesting to know over the past 10 years how many incidents of pollution there has been in that particular water. But unfortunately, that has come out in the response that we received. And it's the I think that they take some comfort in the fact that these sort of incidents are on the decline. Well, you only take one incident to destroy a river actively for a long, long period of time. Because once you touch the natural habitat of a river, well, I think it takes years for that to be restored, if indeed it is ever restored to its former glory. And this river has had a long, long history, or at least it appears that way. And maybe, you know, if we could find out just a wee bit more about the number of incidents and the source of the incidents on that, whether it's done by big industry or what, I'm not sure. But I'd like to know that, and I think to have that, those facts in front of it.
I would certainly be keen to seek that information as well from the department. Any other members, any other comments on that?
Just one further point in that. It's Northern Ireland Water was responsible for quite a number of pollution incidents, but it does say in the letter, in the concluding paragraph, so that there's been a reduction in NIW-related pollution incidents over the past 7 years, as far as it strips any other sector. Now, that is a good thing, but, you know, having, you know, a primary agency such as Northern Ireland Water being responsible for pollution is very bad in the first instance. So it's things like that that we have to check up on from time to time and see if there is a serious attempt to address what seems to be a systematic pollution of this particular river. I second what Lord Morrow has said. I think that we just keep a very close eye on this, and if necessary, we call people to the committee to give evidence and to see just exactly what is currently happening.
Chair, if we just could add to that, the paper that we do have in front of us says that there's been to date a total of 53 have been heard in court, with more yet to be heard. Now, that's quite startling, so it is. And I think it says fines totaling £93,000 have been imposed. Now, if you have fines of pushing towards £100,000 imposed, then it, I think, strikes the seriousness of them. But I think, you know, if we could get... We do need to keep on watching brief, and someone has made that suggestion, don't have to yourself or all. But anyway, and that's a good thing, and I fully endorse that, but I think just a bit more information around all this would be useful for us.
I think when we go with Alvin's suggestion, actually, we'll be seeking a world briefing on the subject. I think that would do no harm.
Sometime in the autumn.
Okay.
Yep.
Because, I mean, it's going to be a small comfort to know that the overall trend is not as bad as the pollution incidents recently, but I think it's very small comfort to the people involved and in stocking and working on the 6 mile river. So I think that would be appropriate. If members are in agreement, then we'll seek an oral briefing. Michelle's awesome. Oh, yeah, that's a good idea, actually. Do we want it just from the department, or do we want it from the people involved in the Six Mile Water as well?
It'd even be useful if we asked Northern Ireland Water to come along to give an account.
Okay, and what about the users?
I insist on doing this.
Yeah. What about the those that are using the river? Do we want to request?
Yeah, well, I suspect, you know, you're obviously talking about anglers and clubs and stuff like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It might be good to hear from them, because they're the best keepers that you're going to find. And yes, I will extend an invitation.
Okay.
Why not?
We'll do that then. We'll extend an invitation to the appropriate people.
Yeah. Chair, go ahead. Chair, I mean, if you're bringing in the NAW, I mean, we need to find out what all the rivers then. You know that there's been incidents, in particular with NAW, because there seems to be a high volume, even though they're low severity.
Okay, we'll look into that. Thank you. Okay, can I refer members to a response on page 8 of the table papers from the department to proposals from the Woodland Trust to create a register of trees of national special interest for Northern Ireland. The response indicates the department believes that local councils are best placed to take this matter forward. I'm sure members, you may have a comment on it. I personally think that I'm quite disappointed, actually, that the department don't see themselves fit to take responsibility for any such register, given that, from our presentation, it certainly appeared that the Woodland Trust was happy to do the bulk of the work on such a project. So I don't know what members feel about this, or do you want to raise it again with the department? Are you happy to forward the response to Woodland Trust and await their comment?
Chair, I think that the real question here is it being done? And if it is to be the councils, then that's fine. I would have a burning issue with that. But I'll have more of an issue with the fact that it's maybe not been done and it's going to slip between two stools here. But if there was a willingness on the councils to do it, rather than an imposition, then I think that would be a good thing.
Okay. Well, do we want to simply forward the response to the Woodland Trust and see what they come back with before we do anything further?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So, Chair, I just think there, you know, that we need to look at that. Maybe this is another offloading, to local councils, and then there's no finance or package going along with it, you know, a finance package going along with it, you know, and councils are struggling here, you know, for, to cover all of these new planning policies and everything else, you know. So I think there, you know, they need to be very careful of what we offload.
Sure, that's why I said that rather than an imposition here, it'd be good to hear from the councils if they're enthusiastic.
Absolutely.
Say, yes, we will, and we're keen to do this. However, if they come back and know there's funding issues here, then I think we want to look at it at that stage again.
Okay.
And maybe it should then be resting with the department.
Okay. Well, we'll actually write to the councils then and get their opinion on the matter as well. Thank you. Okay. Members, we have... I refer you to a response from the Department of Petition about the name of Newry Moreland Down Local Government District on page 9 of the table papers. Members, are you happy to note the response? Happy to note? Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to item 5, just consultations. Members, the consultation cover note is page 21 on your pack. Members, do you have any comments, or are you content to request a synopsis of responses to the consultations listed?
Happy enough, sure.
Okay. Item 5.3 on page 25 is from the Assembly's EU Affairs Manager. Notifying the committee of an EU consultation on proposals for a circular economy. The Commission is aiming to present a new, more ambitious circular economy strategy in late 2015 to transform Europe into a more competitive, resource-efficient economy, addressing a range of economic sectors, including waste. The strategy will be fully aligned with the priorities of the new Commission and will comprise a revised legislative proposal on waste. And the closing date for the consultation is the 20th of August 2015. The members, are you content to write the department to ascertain their input into the consultation?
Stage.
Thank you. Item 5.4 on page 27 is a synopsis on responses to the consultation on proposals to adopt maximum 90 days allowed under EU regulations for the downloading of data from digital tachographs, which is an increase from the current download period of 56 days. The consultation ran from 25th of September until the 18th of December 2014, and a total of 6 responses were received. The majority of respondents supported the proposals. However, the PSNI expressed concerns that adopting the 90-day limit would allow more time for rogue operators to manipulate data and make it harder to examine, and would make it more difficult to trawl through the larger chunks of data for investigative purposes. The department believes that these enforcement challenges need to be balanced against the additional burden that would be created on businesses by maintaining the 56-day maximum, and therefore will proceed with its proposal to increase to 90 days, which would be on a par with the rest of Great Britain and Europe. So, members, have you any comment on this? Are you happy for the department to prepare the SL1 for legislation?
Yeah, what did the police say on it in relation to this?
The police weren't so keen on the 90-day limit. They thought it would allow more time for rogue operators to manipulate data and make it harder to examine, and that it would make it more difficult to trawl through larger chunks of data for investigative purposes.
And they suggested, what did they suggest then? 56?
I presume remaining at the 56.
Keep it at the 56, yeah.
Okay.
So they would only be looking at 56 days of data instead of 90.
The 56.
Any other comments, members?
Everybody should agree with it.
Yeah, would you like an oral briefing on this? We could tease it out a bit more.
Well, it might be good then to hear the rationale behind the 90 days again, and then we now know that the police are saying 56, and they give the reasons as to why they. I would be of a mind to go with the 56 days. However, I'm quite happy to wait for a briefing and to be convinced that it should be 90.
Okay. But will we ask the PSNI then for a written brief, and then we can get the oral briefing?
Yeah, well, if they can elaborate more on the 56-day suggestion. And I know they've said they've given a reason there, which is quite convincing, but more information on wouldn't be any.
Okay. Members in agreement?
Yep.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to item 6. It's an SL1, the Planning Development Management Amendment Regulations, Northern Ireland 2015, at page 41 on your pack. The purpose of this rule is to amend a minor drafting error in the Planning Development Management Regulations Northern Ireland 2015, which was considered and agreed by the committee at its meeting on the 12th of March 2015. The word "and" was omitted and resulted in a different interpretation than was intended. The statutory rule is subject to negative resolution and is proposed to come into operation on the 3rd of July 2015. So, members, are you content for the department to proceed with making the rule? Thank you. Item 7, draft statutory rule, local government exclusion of non-commercial consideration order, Northern Ireland 2015. That's on page 48, members. The purpose of this statutory rule is to replicate the provisions of the 2012 order to enable councils to consider the inclusion of social clauses in their contracts. The order also specifies matters that will cease to be non-commercial matters and will enable councils to consider these matters in procurement processes to the extent permitted by EC procurement directives. The committee was briefed on the background and purpose of the order at its meeting on the 30th of April. At that time, the committee was content for the department to proceed in making the order. The order is subject to affirmative resolution procedure. The examiner of statutory rules has not yet commented on the order. If members are content, I'll put the question. It's the Committee for where the environment has considered local government exclusion of non-commercial consideration, Order Northern Ireland 2015, and subject to the report of examiner of statutory rules, recommends that the rule is affirmed by the Assembly. Our members agreed. Thank you. Item 8, the report on the programme of the NIE Prosperity Agreements, Progress and Performance, Departmental Briefing. Members, there's a briefing paper from the department at page 56 in your pack. And if we just welcome our officials.
Yeah, Chair, before you start the briefing, Chair, I'd just like to put on record, I may, obviously it's a table paper in relation to the name change in Newry Morning Down. Maybe I may need to bring something forward in the future just in relation to that matter. I just want to put that on record. Okay. I know there's response here
from the
department today, but it's something we may need to revisit, okay?
Okay, you have that on record.
All right.
Can I welcome Mr. Wesley Shannon?
Thank you.
From the Environmental Protection Division of the department, and Mr. Steve Aston from the department. Thank you very much. You're very welcome. And I want to just invite you then to give us your brief into the background operation of the Prosperity Agreements. Thank you.
Sure. If I could just start. So I'm currently acting Chief Executive of the Environment Agency, just to correct the title.
OK, thank you very much for that.
I've taken over from Terry O'Hearn, who left the department back in March. Steve is head director of our Innovation Strategies Division within the agency, just to set out where we come from. But thank you very much indeed for the
chair.
Before I start, I was listening to some of the earlier conversations, particularly about the river pollution incidents in Styx Mide Water, and the response to that, you've asked for obviously more detail and potentially an oral brief, and we'd be very happy to provide that. That's part of my sort of responsibility, and we can provide both the up-to-date data for not only Styx Mide Water but for other pollution incidents, and we can certainly, there will be officials can be more
That's
than happy
great.
To come and do a presentation.
That'd be much appreciated, thank you.
Okay. Just in terms of the prosperity agreements, I hand over Steve. You have some papers sent to you, which includes obviously quite a bit of material. I'm going to hand over in a moment or two just to Steve to run through that and highlight the key issues. But I just want to maybe just take 2 minutes to set the context. In the last 18 months, my predecessor Terry O'Hearn, who I mentioned earlier, has been leading a comprehensive programme to reform the way Northern Ireland Environment Agency actually regulates the environment, so as we can deliver a simpler and more resilient regulation, because those of you who are long-standing members of the committee will know that the environmental regulation is complex and can be very difficult for both for individuals who are regulated to understand it. So we've been trying to get a system which works better so that people understand how they need to comply and what their obligations are. But that's led us to a very simple operating principle, which Terry coined. It was basically that we're trying to make it easy for people to do good business and make it difficult for people to do bad business. And so that was a very simple and powerful statement. And the principles underpinning that are in your papers. And what we're trying to do is we're looking at really four tiers. Those who are deliberately breaching environmental regulations, in other words, the worst performers, we're making sure that our system will make it both difficult for them, expensive for them, and it will be very direct and robust. There are then those that are maybe occasionally breaching environmental regulation, and that's either through not understanding fully what they need to do or they don't have the capacity to do it. And in those circumstances, the way we intend to regulate will be to be supportive and allow them a degree of help to bring them into compliance. In other words, we work with them. And then there are companies or businesses or individuals who regularly comply, and they will find our new regulatory system both cheap, easy and quick to comply with, and those are the best performers. And then there are another set of people or businesses or organisations who actually want to go beyond compliance and see environmental regulation as a benefit to their business, and those are looking to sort of unlock opportunities, economic opportunities because of environmental compliance. And they're the sort of visionary companies. It's the latter two categories, those that are already regularly complying and those that want to go further, that the prosperity agreements are primarily aimed at. And looking to see how we can take individual companies who have got a good compliance record, who then can use that to boost their own benefits, but also delivering good environmental outcomes. So that's just to set the context. It's part of a wider transformation program where we're trying to improve the regulatory environment. At that point, I want to hand over to Steve, and he can go through the detail of what you've got in front of you by way of your papers.
Okay. Thank you, Wesley, and thank you, Madam Chair, committee members, for the opportunity to talk about this subject, which is really particularly innovative, and it's great to see Northern Ireland leading on a global basis. Nobody else does this, and we have very high hopes for its achievements. Whenever you mention prosperity agreements, you normally prompt three questions. What on earth is it? A more sceptical, why bother with an agreement? Aren't people supposed to comply with the law? And finally, well, how does it work anyway? So I thought it might be helpful for me just to put that in its most simple terms, and then I'll move to the slides and add a little bit more detail before taking any questions. Unless there's something I say that you don't understand, by all means stop me in my tracks and ask. On what is a prosperity agreement, there's the polished answer is a voluntary agreement through which an organisation and the agency can explore opportunities for reducing environmental impacts in ways that create prosperity and well-being. That sounds a bit woolly to me. What I think it really means is you have a public recognition of achievement by a company in terms of environmental performance, and you have a public promise of what they're going to do, not only to stick to that performance, but to go beyond it. And it's that public nature which makes it a binding contract and transparent to members of the public. What it is not a get-out-of-jail card. You can't get a prosperity agreement unless you have a track record of compliance. And after that consideration, you're promising to adhere to those standards, and the powers of the regulator are retained. If we need to enforce, if we need to remove, we will do both of those things. It is then really a working platform that enables the regulator to concentrate its resources where they're most needed. And I think this is actually quite an important point. The agency itself regulates about 7,500 businesses. We have over 500 waste companies. We have approaching 100 top-line companies from intensive farming to power generators, and 6,500 industrial consents and water discharges, a subject which came up earlier this morning. For us to focus on where those things are going wrong, we need to get into an agreement with companies who are doing the right thing and help them do even better, because that allows us to concentrate where it matters. The second is, why bother with an agreement? Aren't companies supposed to comply? What's in it for them, essentially? And it's not really just about what's in it for them. It's about what's good for the environment and good for the economy and good for the regulator. Well, the regulator secures and stretches environmental achievements from the company. It deals with longer-term things in terms of action on climate change, wider action to include biodiversity, and deeper impacts on recovery and the reuse of resources. These are things we can't regulate them into doing, but we invite them to do so with our expertise and with the reassurance they will comply with emission standards. The second is, for the company, they simply become more competitive. They save on bottom line costs. They find themselves influencing their suppliers, and they find themselves having their contracts being influenced in terms of selection from a global market who want products from a company which is a high environmental performer. Roughly translated, we think we achieve more by agreement than by control, and there's more success, more jobs, and more influence. So how does it work? Well, there are three tests. I've indicated the track record of compliance is an absolute prerequisite, as is a willingness to work in partnership, working together, and to innovate, and we have to have companies that have the opportunities to actually develop new ways of doing things. And we have, on our first two prosperity agreements in Lafarge, we have a possibility of actually using waste tyres to act as a carbon substitute, which is saving on carbon footprint of about 6,500 cars equivalent. And with Linden Foods, we have new methods of actually working the plant to save a staggering 25% of carbon dioxide emissions. Neither of those things we could have regulated for, but are part of that agreement. And it's not us going soft. It's a very firm handshake and a very public one. And we have an action plan with commitments, with timelines, and with review periods. So it's an active matter. On the slides, I'll just touch on those. The first one sets out in detail prosperity agreements. And I just want to emphasise that we're trying to work on spending less time in processing and more time in actually getting outcomes. So the business itself can work on its core activity, and we can work on what, where we're most needed. The companies are very carefully selected, and they are only signed if we're going to get significant environmental and economic results. Otherwise, it's a piece of paper. And we are simply not about that. We're about making things better in terms of direct outcome. On the second slide, which has the colours of pink and green, what we talk about there essentially are pink and green zones. Traditional regulators spend most of the time going between non-compliance and full compliance, and people rise up to the top and then they fall back down, and then we step back in and we rise up to the top and fall back down. And we want to break that cycle, because very often companies rely on their standards being set by the agency. In other words, they will do what the agency asks it to do, but only when we ask. And it's a little bit like the mischievous use of the MOT system, where people get their cars checked out to find out what's wrong with it, so they're only fixing what they need to for a safety level. But we want to go beyond a mere environmental safety level, beyond the basics, to something which actually contributes more to the economy and makes people look at Northern Ireland in a very different way as far as business is concerned. So we need to respond to resources in terms of their security, in terms of energy security. We have population and demographic change, and we have climate change. And it picks up on all of those things. It's making us fit for the big pressures that are coming, and it also makes us fitter for new markets. The third slide gives an indication of some of the additional agreements with Lineage and Lafarge. And they're set out quite clearly there, and you see substitute 35% of coal fuel usage, for example, for Lafarge, and the reduction of water use and waste CO2 emissions. 25% is quite staggering. So it's all about less red tape from us as a regulator, less environmental impact from the company itself. On the last slide, it's entitled Progress and Performance. Some of the achievements post-signing are indicated on the previous slide. We have a number of candidate companies for prosperity agreements, including, for example, AES Power, Coca-Cola, and others that are listed in your paper. And we're looking at their compliance record. And again, if you look across at Business in the Community, which does environmental benchmarking awards, you'll see that both of the companies we've already signed with are at platinum status. They already are very high achievers. And if you cross-reference that with actually the top 100 companies, you see the best economic performers are usually the best environmental performers. So there is no clash between the two. There is a positive feel to all of it. In the next week, we have a prosperity panel where we have people representing the gains that they've made, describing them to us and to other new potential members. We're improving what we call our NetRegs web tool, which gives you free advice anonymously and backs up what we say. We were providing contact points for individual companies. So one of the worst things about approaching the civil service in general is actually getting hold of the person you actually want to approach. We're going to have named people for each company to make sure you have a direct contact if you've got a problem or you see an opportunity. And finally, as a general rule, we are revising our customer service standards, again, to improve contact and access, but simply to reflect on Wesley's earlier words, making it easier for good business to do really well and to be on their side as opposed to constantly on their case. And one of the parts of this which has been more challenging than others is regulators often think that people perform well because the regulators are visiting them very often. I take the reverse view. A number of our companies perform well because they're good at what they do. They understand how they're doing it, and what they want is more expertise and assistance from the regulator, not more policing. They want us to police people that don't comply, and this releases us to do that. And one of the only closing thoughts I have is that following this session, our progress in terms of lining up more prosperity agreements, the committee may wish to consider having members of the companies who've signed up come and say, this is what it does for us. Or if they don't find it so good, this is what it doesn't do for us. So that would give you from the other side of the mirror. That's all.
Thank you very much. That all sounds very positive. And it's good to hear that Northern Ireland is leading the way on this. So just to clarify, this is not happening anywhere else. In the UK, it's unique to Northern Ireland.
I have to credit Terry Ahern, our previous chief executive, for this. I mean, it was very much his innovative thinking brought that approach to it, and has been looking at how he or how the environment could be seen as less of a burden and more of a bonus, and how that can we can end up with a classic, if you pardon the cliche, win-win, where you've got both economic benefit and environmental outcome. And it was his idea, and that has come to fruition. And obviously, we've, as Steve has outlined, we've already got two agreements signed, and we're looking at a number of countries. But it was as far as we know, that was the first approach, and it was certainly it's a unique arrangement that we aren't aware of anywhere else.
Okay, thank you. Well done. Obviously, there are businesses interested in this.
Yeah.
But what level has it been overall amongst businesses to enter into a prosperity agreement? Is it, are you actively promoting them, or are businesses being proactively approached to enter into them?
Both, Madam Chair. One of the things we all, I think, when we see a product which appears to work, We all want a slice of that action. So we've had a number of companies in the 20s now who have approached to say we would like a prosperity agreement. And we have approached a number of other companies who, from our portfolio, are telling us are candidate companies. So we would like to think that within a relatively short term, they're quite hard. Each one is bespoke. So they're quite a lot of work, but they do release capacity once they're signed. We'd like to think we have a cohort of around about 30 as early as we can, and that would mean even more people will want one. Now, we're not going to get all 7,500 companies signed up, because all 7,500 aren't compliant, and we have a job to continue to do as a regulator, both to enforce and to educate. But we have a strong level of interest, and we are interested in having quite a large number to make sure that people stick with their public promise and don't want to go out of that family. And I think that will be another pressure which operates positively.
Okay. And how do you identify suitable businesses? And are there any that come to you or refused as not suitable?
We identify based on the risks and their compliance. So if we have a good compliance track record and a low risk of them breaching that compliance, they become candidate companies subject to their willingness. Well, that's perhaps shown by the interest in approach, but also the ability to actually get significant gain and what they're prepared to sign up to do beyond compliance. And some companies come who would want one and their compliance track record isn't good enough. So we highlight that fact to them and say, this is what it would take to reassure us that your compliance is strong enough for us to consider it, because this has to be signed off at ministerial level. And that's one of the difficulties of being in office, that you're also putting your hand into that public handshake to say, yes, I'm satisfied that this company will continue to perform. So that's the test.
And what about the lifetime of the prosperity agreement? How do you ensure that compliance is met with the regulation?
Promises, it's a powerful question and an important one. They're not lifetime awards. The period of major review is over 3 years. They're signed up for a three-year period, and we would expect to see an annual review where the company comes forward and says what it has achieved, and we will say what we have done in order to help them achieve that. So we have to perform as well, which is the other side of the sword. We can't just be a traditional regulator. We have to provide information. We have to provide the contact point. It's not a sign and forget contract. It's a very active working platform.
The important thing as well, just to add to what Steve said, is that it's signed at chief executive level or chief operating officer level in the company, along with the chief executive here, and the first two have also been signed by our minister. So it's a voluntary agreement at that level. So there is a big reputational issue for both the agency and for the organisation. So the point is, there is this review, the annual statement of progress plus the 3 year length of the agreement, but there is definitely a need to a constant review that it is working throughout. So if something were to start getting a wee bit wobbly, for example, there is that high level agreement to sort of ability to sort it out quickly.
Sounds a very interesting project. I know some other members wanting in. Cahill,
thanks very much, Madam Chair, and thank you for your presentation. Just outside of the compliance, I mean, is this situation where you're trying to
get the companies to, you know, better housekeep, you know, look after businesses. Because, I mean, clearly you were saying there the compliance goes up and down at some points. So, I mean, just trying to figure out, I mean, who does the assessment on that? Who does the checks? I mean, when you sign up this agreement, do you, are you saying to the companies, well, somebody has to keep an eye on this, or what's the compliance checks, or how do you go about achieving all of that, or how does that work out then?
We can't not look at the companies, because that's our statutory responsibility, but companies will supply the data in terms of discharge analysis or emissions analysis. They may choose to supply that through a third party, which is accredited, but it means that our inspection regime can be lowered because they're still under this obligation to meet the environmental standards. And if there were to be an incident where they breached, there was a water pollution incident or an emissions incident, that wouldn't make them immune from prosecution or losing the agreement. It would be their response to that breach and the nature of the breach. But it, as part of your question, our audit regime should be reduced because we're confident that they will maintain their compliance. I mean, some of the companies who are controlled by the Integrated Pollution Inspectorate have a very, very good compliance record. And back to the point I made earlier, is that because we're always present or because the companies are competent and they have a culture of compliance? And in most of the companies we are looking at here, they have a culture of compliance. They would, and the shareholders would be horrified if they breached. Whereas we do deal with other companies who seem to be less consistent, shall we say, put in gentle terms, that they're less bothered by non-compliance, which exercises us greatly.
The point I just add, it's the audit level isn't gone altogether. As Steve has said, it's reduced. So we still do have a system whereby we check. The point is, that really, because we are confident in what they do, the audit can be at a more appropriate level, and that releases our resources for elsewhere for the less compliant ones that Steve's talked about.
No, I get that point. The point I'm making, it can be compliant, but in terms of good housekeeping and doing things better, you know, trying to incentivize companies as opposed to using the compliance and the big stick approach, that's the way forward. That's the kind of idea would be.
But
in terms of just identifying and trying to sign up these agreements, I take it the nature of the business obviously is going to be a higher carbon footprint. I mean, have a list of those and those are the ones that you're engaging with primarily first, you know?
Yeah,
very much so. That we would also, we're looking at prosperity agreements with some of the trade bodies as well as a possibility, where instead of getting one company captured, you get a whole range of companies within that trade body captured. And what we're able to draw attention to by our expertise and by the results of other companies is that people are making bottom line savings because they're diverting their waste, they're reusing their waste, they're using less energy. And there is nothing more persuasive to a company than actually saving money. And nothing worse than having a regulator insisting on a raft of things which actually aren't seen by the company as contributing to the environment or helping their core business. And that's where we're joining up, and it's working well. If we take Lafarge, the emission standard doesn't change at all, but actually substituting a fuel with tyres can be quite challenging because the definition of tyres in terms of the waste stream is very precise and how you can where it has to go. And also the emission standards are extremely tight, and rightly so. Neither of those vary, but as a regulator, we've been able to talk to the company and combine the two. And that's a real opportunity to save on carbon footprint and to save on costs. So that's how it's working. It's actually taking that chance of getting a double gain.
Just to add to the point that Steve's made about Lafarge, the other element of it, it helps us as an environment agency also address another issue we have in waste tires, for example. So if we've got a company that is prepared to find an alternative source of fuel to reduce their own costs and their own carbon footprint, and part of that source is something like waste tires, where we have a problem, and we can look at the regulatory environment relating to waste tires and work with the company. Again, we are still making sure that everybody is complying with the regulatory framework, but it means that we can help that business at least then benefit, and we get the environmental benefit as well by diverting waste tires. So it's the prosperity agreement is between ourselves and the company, but it does potentially have significant extra environmental benefits from our point of view.
Thank you. Alden?
Thank you very much, Chair, and thank you for your contribution this morning. Terry Ahern, his reputation was very high in relation to dealing with the environment and environmental protection, and I suppose in a sense it's part of his legacy.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very innovative scheme and one which I think all of us would welcome. It was a good example of government actually helping business, working with business, not being a big brother, but actually as a partner and an enabler. And that's what I like about this particular scheme, that it will encourage a better environment and a stronger economy, and that's what we all want. One worries slightly, and I say only slightly, that although these are compliant companies and companies that may even go beyond simple compliance plus, that what happens in a situation where they slip, where standards fall, where they are actually in default of their commitments. What happens in that situation in relation to?
If someone defaults, if they have a discharge which causes a fish kill or an emission which significantly breaches a limit, it's how they would address that in terms of remedy if there's been environmental damage, and how they would remedy it in terms of reducing the risk in future, whether that's with a new system for stack emissions or a new control in terms of water discharge. There's no question that the possibility of prosecution is as equal to a company that doesn't have a prosperity agreement. There is no distinction between the two.
Right, yeah.
The second thing is whether or not we would withdraw the prosperity agreement.
Yes.
That will depend on the response.
Yeah.
And it still remains up to the courts to make their judgment. And again, as members will be familiar, courts will often adjust their penalties depending on the mitigation response of the company. And one of our key roles is to work with them on innovation. And so we will find other areas of monitoring, other areas of practical steps that prevent a discharge or divert it or use it in some other way. We will share that. And a lot of this is about sharing experience between companies and regulators, so people take immediate advantage of it. But no, it doesn't confer immunity. I'm afraid, like knighthoods, they can be withdrawn.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chair.
No other questions?
There are two companies here cited on the presentation, Linden Foods or Linergy, which is a subsidiary of Linden Foods, and Lafarge. And on the Lafarge, Cookstown, you're saying here that it's equivalent to removing 6,500 cars from the road, this minimum of 10%. And you're also, well, you're not saying, for instance, that reduction as in Linden is equivalent to removing, well, it'll be twice that amount, 13, 15. But in relation to those two, are these two examples, or is this the only two?
This is the only two. The point that Steve made earlier, there is quite a bit of work has to go into developing the agreement, and once you do that, then you reap the benefit afterwards. So there's a bit of an invest-to-save approach. You end up putting effort in and then benefiting from the environment afterwards. We have other candidate companies in train or thinking. I think it's in your paper. There's some examples. This really is only been in gestation in the last 18 months or so, during Terry's later time. So we've managed to get these two signed. We fully intend to sign more. In fact, we have a programme for a departmental objective in our plan to sign a further three this year. The hope and expectation is that then we can continue the programme. But the point is, these are agreements that are at the sort of top end of the business world. So we are wanting to get them right. It may be that we can accelerate the number or how quickly we get the further companies signed up. But these are the only two signed so far. But as I say, there are at least three more in fairly advanced development, and we have other candidate companies we're looking at. And as I think Steve said to the chair earlier, there are other companies who now know about these two who are approaching us rather than us having to approach them.
So the
figure work in relation to things like the equivalent of 6,500 cars, that's just an attempt to try and put the carbon reduction into a comparative. We generally talk about greenhouse gas emissions and translate it into carbon equivalent reductions. So it's really just to try and do an illustrative example of what that means in other fields.
So would it be fair to say that these two here, you see them more, is this more as a pilot scheme? Or are you continually bringing on new companies? Because you have perfected as far as you can go, so this is not just...
I'm not sure I would use the term pilot, but I don't want to split hairs on it. They are the first two, and we will learn from them.
Right.
I'll go back to my analogy with products. You get what we call early initiators, people who see a new car or a new washing machine, and and this is a new product, and these are the first two companies that meet the test. And it's been very... very detailed in the work that we've done with them, and then they will represent next week to other companies how they've gone through the process and what the benefits are. So it's not us actually selling, it's the person we've sold it to who are selling it to other companies.
What's your time scale here in relation to, for instance, the two where you think that they've moved from a position of trial to perfection, if that's the right word to use?
Well, they're in a position of actually, they've made a public commitment to achieve these targets, and we will monitor that achievement. And the timescale is that they will achieve the targets over the 3 years that we signed up to the agreement. And by the end of the three-year period, I'd like to think there were 30 companies, not the three that we've guaranteed for this year.
When did you sign up the two companies here, Justin?
Are
18 months into your...
No, 18 months on the programme, but they've done not 18 months in. The first one was last August.
Right.
And Lafarge was in March past.
Right. So we'll have to just wait a wee while to see how it goes.
Yeah.
In time, you'll be bringing others on board, hopefully.
Yep.
You mentioned there that, that you're learning. Is there anything specifically you have learned through working with the first two companies?
I think there are one or two practical approaches in terms of how we can have tools that we can offer to other companies just from the partnerships by the way in which a company handles something or does something. We've learned that they produce figures very quickly to demonstrate cost savings, and that's very persuasive to anyone else. And we've learned to be a bit more trusting. That's actually quite hard as a regulator because our reputation goes on the line. And if something goes wrong, and things do go wrong, we don't want the whole concept of prosperity agreements to be ruined because someone's had a bad day. So we need to be robust, but we need to trust. And that's not normally what regulators do. Start off with a healthy degree of scepticism.
Chair, sorry, one point I would suggest that the one of the elements of the Lindsay Linden Prosperity Agreement is to establish a stakeholder forum, and that's one thing that is definitely seems to be producing a significant degree of benefit, where they're talking to local neighbours and landowners and other stakeholders, and that's a powerful element of that process, so over and above the figure work of reductions in emissions and so on. So that's one where I think other companies will be interested to see how well that works, because obviously your neighbouring farms, houses or residences, it's an important element of the business.
Okay, thank you. Ian Millen.
Thank you, Chair. Just want to ask, what engagement to date have you had with local councils, for example, because they would seem to me to be a quite big player in all of this, and I just want to know, how you're going to approach that, and this would be a means of driving the process forward.
I engage with the councils during their period of transition to become the new and powerful bodies that they are has been limited. We've taken views because they regulate a number of processes on a similar vein, but not at the same scale. And I take that question as a suggestion that that's an action that we should undertake, because I think it is. We now have the evidence that we can share with councils, and they are the much more local beneficiaries. The tendency is to operate with very large companies because of the scale of gain. But the reality is that most companies are much smaller, and there's no reason for them not to gain in a similar way, so the cumulative effect would be good. So I'll, with the permission, Madam Chair, I'll take that on board as a proposal and take it forward.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay, Colin.
Thanks, Chair. Thank you for your presentation. I think it's very good and positive. As other members have said, I think it's important that we facilitate business as well as bring their hammer around on them when they go wrong. But you mentioned there about the size of these businesses. They're obviously quite large businesses in comparison to a lot of other businesses. Is there any, are you thinking about bringing this down to much smaller businesses or a different level of agreement, a different type of agreement, so that more and more businesses can get involved in this type of initiative?
The answer is yes. The question is one of timing. We need, and the committee's demonstrated this very well this morning, there's a point at which you need to go from the concept to where it's been proven to work, and then to be able to share that, and the scale changes. So the answer will be a definite yes, which is why we're looking at trade associations where a number of their members are much smaller, but the cumulative effect of, for example, Construction Employers Federation is quite significant. So we would seek to use their influence in their offices to have members that want to show an interest in prosperity agreement and have this good compliance track record. So that will be an inevitable rollout, because no one, no company, no matter what scale, should be denied the opportunity of one of these agreements.
Could I just add to that? What Steve said, obviously we are looking to, you know, do it for size, in terms of size of company. You mentioned there about the type of agreement or the quality. We're not intending to change the status of the agreement. The Minister has been very clear with us that this is a brand that he wants to keep as a quality brand. So if you're a small company, you would still need to be signing up at a level where it's reputationally important and therefore delivering on the environmental and economic benefits. So the brand and the quality of the agreement will still be the same, albeit with different size of companies. So I think it's just an important point. The Minister has been very keen to emphasise that, though.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, I don't think there are any further questions. So just before we let you go, almost on the back of Colin's question, are there any other programmes or initiatives of this type on the horizon?
Well, as I said at the beginning, we're in the process, which again was started by Terry, in trying to improve our regulatory approach and transform into a better regulatory environment. So this is a particular aspect of that spectrum, if you know what I mean. So we will be bringing forward, or we are working to try and be a more streamlined, simpler but effective regulatory environment. There are things like we are hoping to bring forward the Better Regulation Bill, which will be an element of that overall regulatory transformation, so as to allow for an easier system, or an easier understood and easier managed regulatory system. So there are a number of other aspects of that regulation transformation, pardon the rather long words, but this is the initiative within that spectrum that we feel most proud of, if you know what I mean, in terms of what it might deliver. But if there are other specific discrete things, we'll more than happy to bring them back to the committee when we're at a stage where we can give you a decent report.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. Much appreciated.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, members. I don't think we actually have any actions out of that briefing, but just throwing it out there, whether you would want maybe to have a briefing from one of the companies who are actually involved in this process, you know, who actually have a prosperity agreement, or whether you intend to note.
Well, Chair, I think that, yeah, that's a good enough idea, but I think it's a bit premature. Mm-hmm. I'd like to see it further down the road, and so what some of them was March, I think they said. It was
last August.
And so I'd like to see at least a full year.
Maybe something we can look at again then?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, moving on to item 9. It's the Local Government Performance Indicators and Standards Order, Northern Ireland 2015, and Guidance on Local Government Performance Improvement. We're going to have a departmental briefing now. Your briefing paper is at page 72, and the synopsis of the responses is at page 12 of the table papers. So I want to welcome the officials. Welcome to Susan Wilkham, William Duclo, and Nicola Cray.
Hi.
So I don't know which of you wants to lead off on this.
I will, thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Madam Chair. As you've said, I'm Nicola Cray from the Department of Environment, and I look after, in the local government side, issues around performance management and community planning in particular. And as you said, William Duclo from Environmental Policy Division and Susan Wilkham from Planning are here today as well. First of all, thank you very much again for the opportunity, obviously, to talk about this morning. Before we start, if I could just draw the committee's attention to one particular issue that's arisen, and that's in relation to within the order itself, around the planning indicators and standards. It has become obvious when we were looking at this that there was a drafting error, really, and it relates to the first two indicators, which are about the processing times for major and local applications, and that inadvertently excluded consent regimes, which are listed building consents, hazardous substance consents and conservation area consents and advertising consents. And they have always been included in the measurement of the applications, but they were just accidentally excluded in the guidance notes. Now, I must emphasise that it doesn't in any way change the standards for planning, which remain at 30 weeks for major applications and 15 weeks for local applications, but it just is really a technical amendment that will be needed, which will happen obviously prior to the order being put in place and will be sent to the committee. So just having got that out of the way, if we could just say a few words around performance improvement more generally. And I think it is important when we talk about performance improvement that it has traditionally, I think, and sometimes still been looked at as something which is quite punitive and something which is done to people, and certainly something which councils may have regarded as something which is imposed upon them, and which in some ways I think people generally maybe view as something which gets in the way of their work rather than something which supports their work. And I think what we want to do is try and move much beyond that. Performance improvement in the context of local government reform is actually a very important part of the overall infrastructure. It really is the support, part of the support structures for around partnership panel and community planning. And it's really about improving services for people. And that's the important thing. And I think that's what we're trying to get at with the order and the guidance. This isn't something which is placed upon councils and which is something which they should regard negatively. But it really is an opportunity to try and improve performance for citizens. And that's what the point of it is. So I think that is an important point to make, because I know performance improvement can be viewed in quite a negative light a lot of the times, and that isn't what we want. The order itself then, obviously, which you have before you and which we've consulted upon with local government, and there's two aspects here. There's the order itself and then there's the guidance. And the order is provides an opportunity for central and local government to work together to create standards and indicators for particular services. And in this instance, those services are planning, waste and economic development in the form of startups of new businesses. So again, you know, to emphasise the point that although that the legislation and the order create a system where local government is reporting on those type of indicators and providing a service, it's not that they're reporting to central government on this. This isn't about local government doing something for central government. It's about local government doing something for citizens. So in relation to planning, for instance, it's not that they're doing that for central government, because that was was something that central government used to do. It's about that they're doing this for the citizens and they should be aiming to improve the service for citizens. So the improvement, performance improvement guidance then very much relates to issues that a council would want to take on board in terms of its own setting, its own improvement standards. So central government isn't imposing any particular standards in local government there, but what we are doing is providing some statutory guidance around how they might identify and put in place a performance improvement system, which again supports improvement, and which again very much links back to issues like community planning, because the improvement improvements that they aim to put in place as part of that structure should be very much those which they've identified, for instance, through their community planning process. Now, the order itself is very much related to trying to ensure that there is that connectivity between central and local government, so it does concentrate on programme for government targets. And what we would want to do is look again, when the next programme for government is put in place, at what might be the appropriate standards and indicators that would be put in place at that point in time, and which then would provide that linkage back through programme for government and back to the partnership panel. And likewise, on the improvement guidance which is in place, that's very much something which we're regarding as an initial set of guidance, because obviously councils only come into being on the 1st of April of this year, so this year is very much a base year. So we want it very much to not impose a very difficult or restrictive regime in councils in that first year, but to let them develop, let them identify those issues which are important to them and to their citizens and those areas that they wish to identify for improvement. So the first year, the 15-16 year, is very much a base year, and councils are asked to do basically work around identifying areas that they may wish to target for improvement rather than being faced with a huge improvement regime. So really that's a bit of the context, and really William and Susan can certainly answer any questions that you may have in relation to the more detailed issues around waste and planning and on economic development. As you know, we don't have anybody there from that particular department. They have given some information on that side of things. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Just in relation to the actual responses to the consultation on the proposed legislation, can you elaborate on some of the key concerns that the councils have raised and tell us if and how they've been addressed?
Certainly, in relation to the order itself, general consensus on the particular targets or indicators and standards that have been put in place, and there wasn't a great deal of dissent about what they should be. Now, there was some issues raised around planning, again, just on the wording of how the targets around planning or the indicators around planning had been expressed, and they were taken on board and amended. Again, in relation to economic development, a particular issue that was raised on quite a few occasions was a comment, I suppose, more around whether the actual measurement of startups was appropriate, shall we say, and if it was something which actually did really measure whether, you know, you had actually got this number of startups in your area. And I think really the response to that from the department is that you can certainly make some commentary about whether it's good or bad, but it is the standard one that has been used. And again, it is the one which is currently expressed within Programme for Government. So although there may be some maybe issues around it, and that's something which obviously the department itself in relation to DETI would be looking at, it is the one that has been used. So in the interest even of continuity and ensuring that there was a consistency of approach, I think it's necessary to continue, certainly for this 15-16 year, to use what was there previously. And they would have probably been the main issues that were raised.
Okay, and I know one council considered the planning standards were more restrictive than what was in place for DOE planning?
Probably maybe Susan could answer that better than me.
Yes, there was, as Nicola says, there was general agreement and a broad consensus that this was a good idea. The suggestion that the indicators and standards were more restrictive than the department had been dealing with is actually incorrect. The figure for local as 15 was what the department were meeting in the previous year. The figure for major is a little bit different because we didn't have that hierarchy before, but on a like-for-like basis, our statisticians have worked out that the target of 29 weeks was actually being met. So it's not actually more restrictive in terms of those figures themselves.
Okay. Okay, Grant. Ian Gray?
Yeah, a couple of questions. The economic development standards, and I represent the Mid-Ulster constituency, I'm intrigued as to how the figures have been achieved. You know, the Mid-Ulster areas promote following number of jobs, which is 210, mm-hmm. in comparison to some of the other councils is quite a wee bit higher. Is a Derry's figure, or is there an exact science as to how this came about?
That is set out by Derry as to how they do it. And it's all based on the numbers of business plans which are put in place in the area. And obviously they would use historic data in setting the targets. Now, they've set that out in the guidance, and it would be something I'd maybe prefer to come back to you on if I could, even because I wouldn't want to answer, in detail in relation to how Derry do something, because I think that is something that, that they would be better placed to answer. But I can certainly give you a written more full answer on that from Derry, but it is something that they established, yes.
And in respect of the waste management standard, again, sort of something similar, how's that decided? How's it that the Mid-Ulster's with 21,330 in comparison to similar size, well, I suppose most of them similar size councils now, depend on the land mass, of course, but is there a calculation used to get to that figure?
Yes, certainly. Methodology that was used to arrive at those figures was the same, on the same basis as was used originally for the 2005 figures. It's a simple population model, so it's really per head of the population. That's how it's been worked out.
Okay.
And I should say that the figures in the order relate to 2015-16. For the waste management standard. There are figures for the continuing years until 2020, and they have already been agreed and been issued to councils, to the new councils. So councils will be aware of these figures as from, I think it was July last year, they were notified of these figures.
Given that everybody wants to see a reduction in the amount of waste going to landfill, and many places are trying to shut down their landfill sites, is this a figure that has been reducing? Whilst, yes, it's per head, is it a continually reducing figure to try and get it down to as low as possible?
Yes, over the last 10 years, really, since the start of the Northern Ireland Landfill Allowance Scheme in 2005, there's been a quite significant fall in the amount of waste sent to landfill right across Northern Ireland, across all council areas. And we see that trend has continued to show itself over the last number of years, and I see no reason why it shouldn't continue to fall. And to that extent, I think these standards are realistic and achievable.
And I've nothing to say that they're not, but are they rigorous enough targets to ensure that as little as possible is put to landfill, or are they sort of middle of the road just to try and ensure that they can be achieved?
I do think they're achievable and realistic, but they're really based on
They're based on the overall EU requirement to reduce landfill by 2020 right across Northern Ireland to a particular figure. And by the time the targets get to 2020, they will reflect that EU target figure. So they're based on what was seen 10 years ago as being a very, very challenging target for 2020. As I say, councils have made tremendous progress in the last 10 years in reducing landfill. And to that extent, I think they are very, the targets for 15-16 are very achievable.
Just on the back of that, as a department, you haven't set a standard to the indicator reference number W1. Mm. What's the rationale for keeping the indicator but not having the standard?
Thank you, Madam Chair. The department did consider placing a target or a standard in the order for recycling, household recycling. However, the main target that we have is the EU target for 2020, which, as you would know, is 50% recycling of household waste by 2020. The order itself doesn't run until, or isn't intended to run until 2020. So it was felt that it wouldn't be appropriate to place that 2020 target in the context of this order. We also have, as you would know, PFG targets for household recycling. There's a target for 2015. There's also a target for 2016. It was felt that, given that the consultation on the order only took place in the early months of this year, and councils would be expected to meet these standards as of April, or as we are now, June of this year. It was felt that wouldn't provide an appropriate enough length of consultation, or indeed period of time between the consultation and the time that councils were expected to meet the standard. I think the department would be very open and indeed keen on the idea of introducing targets for household recycling in future iterations of this order as we move forward. And we can certainly do so, but we would need, I think, to. This is a major issue for councils. It's going back to the member's point about being challenging and unachievable. Mm. This is one, household recycling is one which is very, very challenging. In particular, the PFG target for 2016 is 46%. We're not close to 46%. And I think to have put a standard in this order for 2016 of 46% would have in effect to have imposed a target on councils without, I think, appropriate consultation. But we would like to do so for future years based on proper consultation with councils.
Okay. And is there any budget going to the councils to actually to meet these targets and standards, or is it to be borne by the councils in its entirety?
I'm not sure. Generally, I can speak on behalf of the waste management side. The standard it relates to landfill diversion. There have been initiatives funded through Rethink Waste by the department over the last 3 years. Most of them have been focused on waste prevention and waste recycling. And that will inevitably reduce the amount of waste that will be going to landfill. So I think we have, as a department, through Rethink Waste funding, been supporting councils in meeting landfill diversion targets.
Certainly, just more generally, obviously, in relation to planning, planners and the planning service, obviously, as you well are aware, have transferred to councils in the main, so they have got significant resources to deal with that. And on the economic development side, again, the issues around job startups and a number of other programmes, those responsibilities have actually transferred to councils with the commensurate budget from DETI and Invest NI, so they have received resources to deal with those.
Okay, thank you. Cahill?
Thanks, Madam Chair, and thank you for your presentation. clearly what you're indicating there, just for clarification, the order's coming into place, but you have an opportunity to reset indicators if you need in terms of waste or whatever. The point I'm slightly concerned about is the planning issue. Because I've asked on a number of occasions about a couple of years ago, or maybe 3 or 4 years ago, we done this workforce model, transferred this down to council. I think there's a few problems in transition about that. And I'm just wondering whether or not we're saying here, you know, have we talked to local councils and the rollout of all this, we're only in a couple of months altogether. I think there's a problem with time frames and delivery, in average maybe 15 weeks. You know, how robust is that in terms of the test for these councils to try and achieve those targets in this transition period, even giving them a year? I have to be realistic. The point about the resources, I'll go back, Nicola, I don't know whether the workforce model is correct or not. That's a question this committee may ask in time. But I think that, you know, I'm hearing on the grapevine there's just a few wee teething problems, and hopefully we'll be able to iron them out. But I want to be realistic in what planning, especially at local level, is able to achieve, you know. Maybe even some comments in relation to that.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Susan can answer the detail on it, yeah. But, you know, I think, as you say, you know, there is teething problems, but I think that's inevitable in any you know, change situation of this size. And, you know, I think that, you know, council and the DOE are working very productively together. But Susan, obviously, yeah. You know the detail around that.
Well, certainly this approach in terms of how we are looking at this is very much to be a whole light touch, and the emphasis is to be on improvement as opposed to looking at particular performance, I suppose. And, you know, we're very well aware that each council area may have different issues compared to the one sitting beside them, whether they're maybe more rural or more urban, or, you know, depending on I suppose, the nature of their area. So certainly it's not our intention to be any more anything than supportive in this first year in particular. And as Nicola had said in her opening remarks, this will all be looked at throughout the year, and we will assess whether or not we need to change those standards and indicators at all. We'll also be looking at the possibility of administrative targets as well. So it's not just based on particularly development management and enforcement. We'll look at lighter areas as well to try and assist with an overall performance framework that will help everybody.
Oh, I would support that approach. Just the feedback I'm getting. I mean, clearly there's a few problems there, and I would support whatever measures you need to introduce to protect that, because yeah. I think it's a learning curve for most.
It certainly is, yeah. And, you know, this is in its infancy, and there's nowhere really comparable for the department to look at. So very much so, and we have a team that's going to be set up within the department that will deal specifically with this in terms of support and improvement, and trying to identify with councils any particular areas that they may require us to provide additional guidance or assistance with, or indeed training with.
And obviously the other point versus most public reps is dealing with the applicants. You know, so I think a bit of work yet to be done. The other point, obviously the waste management stuff, and Mr. McRae has touched on. I'm just somewhat bemused at some point. You know, some of the councils are doing really well and other councils are not. And there's different guidelines. There should be a set of guidelines right across the board for everybody in targets. In terms of all that, we've set a target now, but how are you going to ensure that these councils, all councils, are achieving the same aims as, you know what I mean? I know they're doing separate collections in separate different ways, but ultimately, do you think we're robust enough here in what you've said to try and achieve?
If I may answer that particular point, clearly councils do have the autonomy to put in place whatever systems they feel are appropriate to their area, and some of them have been introducing more innovative approaches for waste collection systems and in relation to recycling contracts and so on. And that's to be encouraged, and the department has been encouraging that. But at the end of the day, the targets that are the standard that's set in this order relates to the amount of waste landfilled, and it mirrors legislation that we have on the Northern Ireland Landfill Alliance scheme, and that legislation provides for the possibility of fines if councils do not meet their landfill allowance. So that's a parallel process, but it does mean that if they don't meet their NILAS allowance, there is the potential for them to be fined. And I think that's been the case since 2005, and I think that's actually driven forward the significant improvement in landfill diversion that we've seen across councils.
No, William, I agree with you, and the point is that we know that council, and it's not a criticism of council, this has been operating for a number of years. But if you look at the broader picture and the mindset of even recycling and waste management landfill, it, you know, some councils are achieving better. The point of the matter is you've set a target here and it still seems to be a big stick approach. But we haven't used the stick yet because, you know, there hasn't been infractions. There's a possibility of infractions. I don't want to go down that route. What I want to bring forward is ensure that in 10 years, all the councils are achieving the same aims. That's the point of all of this here. And if you're saying to me it's robust within indicators and performance indicators, we'll achieve that. That's grand. If there's some flexibility to change the time, you know, that's something to do.
Well, I think it's a fair point. I do think that these are they're realistic targets, but they do reflect, as I was saying, the overall EU target of 2020 for landfill diversion, which going back 10 years ago was a very, very big thing and a very big challenge. But going back to the point made by Madam Chair, there is more than one possible standard here for waste management, obviously, and we have an EU target for household waste recycling, and I think that we would, as a department, be very keen in a future order to incorporate targets after consultation with councils in relation to household waste recycling, and that I think would probably be a little more challenging than the landfill diversion ones.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just for clarity, will the councils be responsible for publishing their own performance, or will it be managed by the department?
Well, they will be responsible for publishing the information in relation to their performance improvement that they are responsible for. So if they choose a particular issue that they want to concentrate on, there's a requirement on them to publish that to make sure that their citizens and the local people are aware of that. And they will be required to collect information on that, and that will then eventually, and obviously, as I say, this first year is very much a base year, but obviously as time goes on they will be audited by local government auditor on their performance and what they have actually achieved. And likewise, in terms of the order, they were required to provide that information back to the department as to what they have actually achieved in relation to planning or waste or economic development. And obviously, again, if there was a problem there, the department would be, as Susan has pointed out, in the main helping and, you know, discussing where there may be problems, and dealing with those problems. It certainly wouldn't be a punitive type approach in the first instance. Okay.
Other members have questions? No? Well, just before I let you go then, just the final one from me. When will the department be consulting on the performance indicators standards for 2016 and beyond?
Well, what we would hope to do would be to link that very much up with the next programme for government. So we would like to see what would be in the next programme for government before we would go out and consult on that. The idea again being obviously to lift those programme for government targets that might be appropriate to be part of that performance standard and then go out. So it would follow on from them in terms of the order. In terms of the guidance itself, obviously that's a more iterative process and we're working with councils already on what we'll be putting in place in terms of future guidance for future years. So we'll probably consult on that formally towards maybe the latter part of this year. But I should say that is very much of an ongoing work in progress.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you.
Members, just on the back of that last presentation, have you any actions or further comment to make? Happy enough to enter note stage? Thank you. We're moving on then to item 10, correspondence. And members, the list of correspondence is at page 96 in your pack. Item 10.1 at page 97 is correspondence from Monkstown Community School about safety of a school crossing point. Responsibility for this lies with the Department of Regional Development. Members, are you content that we forward a letter to the Department of Regional Development and copy this to the Regional Development Committee?
Great, Chair.
Members might also wish to send a copy to the Department of Environment.
Content.
Okay, thank you. And I just want to draw your attention to the following items of correspondence for noting. That's item 10.3 on page 100. It's an email from NERDA regarding concerns it has on the department's consultation on financial provision legislation. The consultation is due to end on the 19th of June and the committee has already requested a synopsis of the responses. So are you content to note this until the synopsis is received by the department?
Great.
Thank you. 10.4 on page 101 is from the Agricultural Committee to the Department seeking written evidence as part of its inquiry into better regulation. Members content to note.
Great. Good job.
And members, just to note, the commencement order SR 2015 number 257, C20, the Taxis 2008 Act, commencement number 4, amendment order NI 2015, mouthful, at page 40 of the table paper, so that's just a note.
Great.
Members, have you any other comments on any of these or any other items?
No.
Are you content then with suggested actions on the cover note?
Great.
Okay, then we're on to the forward work programme, which is at 107. The road safety briefing has been scheduled for the 2nd of July. Just to remind you that the committee had previously agreed to invite the Criminal Justice Inspectorate to brief the committee on its report into NIEA's Environmental Crime Unit and the department on its response. And given that we're close to recess, are you content to wait until September or do you wish to receive the briefing before summer recess? If that's the case, we would need an additional meeting. So intend to wait until after recess. Okay, thank you. Any other comments on the forward work programme? I'll content to note. Okay. Any other business members?
No.
Okay, then we have the date, time, place of next meeting, which is Thursday, 18th of June, and it's at 9:45, and it's in the Riverview Suite at the Le Mans Hotel. Thank you very much.
Thank you.